everyone. Welcome to Write On, the podcast from Final Draft. This is a show where we talk about all things screenwriting. I'm your host, Shardé Sellers. Before we get started with our interview of William Eubank of Land of Bad, a quick word about Final Draft, the industry standard screenwriting software. The newest version, Final Draft 13, is now available with new features like writing stats, midnight mode, typewriter view, and more, plus more customization for your navigator and outline editor. Final Draft 13 gives you more tools, more productivity, and more progress. Visit finaldraft.com to learn more. And now, our interview with William Eubank. Hey, William, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Do you prefer William or Bill?
You can call me whatever. Will, Bill, Billy, whatever. No. Okay,
we'll stick with Big Willie. We'll go back.
There you go.
First of all, watch the movie. I have to tell you, I'm going to start charging you for my anti-anxiety medication. I don't think I've ever been so anxious in my life watching this film. But before we get to Land of Bad, I do want to toss it back a little bit to one of my favorite films of yours, Underwater.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate that.
I love that movie. I watch it all. I'm not kidding. I'm not pontificating. I watch that movie at least once a month when I just want to
read
something fun.
Oh, thank you. Yeah. It's such a fun movie. We had so much. Look, that movie was really hard to make, but at the end, we also had a lot of fun making it. So
the reason why I asked that is because Land of Bad is so action packed. And I'm just sitting there as a filmmaker going, oh, my gosh, like the amount of work they had to do. So what lessons did you take from Underwater that prepared you for this movie?
Oh, man. You know, it's all just crazy planning. Like they had their own types of problems, you know, like Underwater was such a painful movie for the actors. That was like the first time I'd really encountered that in my career where, you know, normally you start working on a scene and you're at the monitor and you're watching the performance and you're like, okay, we're going to hone this. We're going to, oh, okay. I see a gem there. Okay. We'll lean into that or we'll do this. And on Underwater, the first day of shooting and they're in those 100-pound suits. I don't remember if it was John Gallagher or TJ Miller or something. They start walking and then they hit a metal thing that was only like this high on the ground. And these suits are 100 pounds. And he just went, boom, and just hit the ground. It just was so loud. It echoed through the whole soundstage. And you could just tell, like, he couldn't get up. So we had to go lift him up. And I was like, he was sweating. And I was like, oh, my God. Oh, my God. I think I only have, like, one more take or two more takes of this. And so you realize, like, everything had to happen in a few takes in those suits. So it was just so hard, you know, because you can't hone anything. So thankfully Underwater, like everyone's in t-shirts and baseball caps. And yeah, the jungle is actually full of leeches. We got everyone had leeches. Oh my God. So many freaking leeches, but it wasn't like 100-pound suit, you know? So thank God I didn't have to plan around that, you know? Yeah. It's a puzzle, you know, and you try to identify what's causing problems and you go from there. Like even on The Signal, Lawrence Fishburne, he was in a big suit, which they ended up using our suits, by the way. They used them for, we designed those suits, my costume person, and then they used them for Stranger Things. I'm like, because we couldn't buy the suits that we designed and made. So we had to like return them to the costume people. And then they appeared in Stranger Things anyways. But yeah, so on that movie, it was so hot for Lawrence. Most of the scenes where you see him in his suit, he's also just like in his boxers. Like, so if you were to pull out, he's just sitting there in his boxers because it's so hot, you know?
How do you, I mean, you're working, like you said, Lawrence Fishburne, and you're working with really Russell Crowe. How are you preparing them for this as a director? How do you get them to trust you when you're like, okay, you've got leeches and you're hot and
it's horrible? Look, it's just, honestly, you just have to be in it with them. You like on Underwater, I directed one day in the suit. That was a bad idea. But at least they see, I'm like, you know, okay, he knows, at least he understands. I think, you know, other people, professionals just want to know that you're professional too, that you have the utmost respect for their craft. And I think when they see how hard you work or the long hours you put in, they go, okay, well, yeah, he's trying and he's giving it everything he has. So I'm going to try to give it back. You know, it's, at least that's worked really well for me up to this point in my career. So just kind of try to keep doing that.
Spectacular. You're pulling performances out of people that are just, when I tell you, like, I'm not a military person because I don't know anything about that world. Like my dad, his name is Major and our grandpa served in the Navy, but I know nothing. And suddenly I feel like I'm a tactical person and I could do this job watching your film. Yeah. But I read somewhere that you were a scout, or you thought about having a military career and then you went to film. Can you
explain? Oh, yeah, yeah. When I was younger, I mean, my little brother is active military and deep in it. I personally was like, when I was in high school, I really wanted to either fly planes or direct movies. I realized like I didn't have the eyesight to fly planes, and I hated math, although I could like do it. I just really was bad. You know, it was the worst. But I was a better artist than I was, you know, solving math problems. So I knew I wouldn't be an engineer, and you really need to be an engineer to like fly planes, at least in the Navy. So yeah, in the end, I went the other direction. I'm glad I did, because I love my job, and it's just like, I can't even imagine if I'd gone into the military. But yeah, we learned a lot about it on this, working with some amazing military advisors. And we spent way, way back when, like 10 years ago, we went out to Fort Irwin and trained with all of the JTAC instructors out there, and just, I mean, it was insane. We were like talking to F-35s and they were blowing up stuff. And it was so crazy that I was like, it really changed even how I saw the story and all that. So
going to the script, though, knowing that and having a brother and going through those tactical trainings, how does one even sit down and start preparing? That's a lot of jargon. That's a lot of.
Yeah. I mean, to be frank, the jargon is like a push and pull thing. Like, so we would write it as best as we could. Then we'd like literally send it to this guy, Kenny, who we named our main character after Kenny. He's a real JTAC instructor. He's retired now, but real JTAC instructor. And he would give us he'd say, hey, this is right, or no, this is wrong. And we did that for years. I mean, because this movie, we wrote it so long ago, and we weren't, you know, we had the time to kind of always be bouncing ideas off of him and realistic things. Then the real challenge is like, and then while we were shooting, Kenny was able to come out and advise the guys on set. So, because there's always on set questions. And then we had the same thing for Russell. We had a real drone operator who had worked at Creech sitting with Russell the whole time. And, you know, those guys are saying, okay, this is how I'd say it. But what's interesting is like, for instance, the term I'm Winchester, which ironically, like Winchester is my little brother's name, but Winchester means I'm out of ammo. And you could say that like on the ground, you could say that, you know, in a plane, but most people have no concept. If somebody starts saying I'm Winchester, they're gonna be like, why is this guy named Winchester? What's going on? It means I'm out of ammo. So, but that's where like Russell is so good. Like Russell will know, all right, I'm going to say I'm Winchester, but then I'm going to quickly say I'm out of ammo, you know, to just follow it up in the performance. So people know what on earth he's talking about, yeah. You know,
which so. I want to talk to you about the humor in the script. I've never found Russell Crowe funnier in my life.
Yeah.
Weird for me growing up, you know, with the Russell Crowe I grew up with and going, oh, he's hilarious.
Yeah. He's so funny. Not only that, like Russell, he's so good. He's always been like, he always plays serious roles, and you know, he's playing a serious role in this as well, but really in person too, he's full of so much life and knowledge on everything. Like, not because he wants to like be a know-it-all, but just literally because he's passionate about so many things. And it's whether it's art or dance or theater or, you know, music, some types of musical instruments. He knows so much about everything. And he has a joy talking about it. Like as he's telling you about this or that little story, there's like always a smile on his face. He's just a person who has so much life and like sort of love for life in him. And that I'm like, you know, I guess the nice guys, if you've ever seen the nice guys, that's like probably peak Russell humor in a way, but it's just fun to like, yeah, because a lot of the lines in this movie, like he's totally making them up, even though he claims that he's not like, he won't do stuff off the cuff. And yeah, he totally does. And it's so good.
Okay. You know, I have to ask, I was like, was the twerking line scripted, or did Russell Crowe just decide he wanted to say twerking? Because I'm never going to live that down. Like, that's going to be.
Oh my gosh. No, that's actually Chica. Chica made that up. So, and then Russell played into it, you know? It was actually Russell's, but here's the thing. It was Russell's idea to dance at the end of the film.
Aww.
And I was like, no, that's going to be crazy. We can't do that, you know? But I'm like, I'm not going to say no. And so I'm like, let's just do it and we'll see how it goes. Listen to my hands. That's his line. He made that up. And then they start dancing. And like everyone on set, like I turn around, people are crying. And I'm like, oh my God, this is amazing. But that's just filmmaking. It's like, if something amazing happens, you totally embrace it and it's going in the film. And yeah, Chica, she was the one who made up the twerking line. She's really off the cuff, and she loves being off the cuff, which we don't, you know, unfortunately, there wasn't a ton of room in some of her space to do that. So I'm so happy she just like suddenly got that twerking line in there. It was so funny.
It's amazing, you guys. Honestly, there's so many reasons for you to see this movie, but hearing Russell Crowe say twerking is probably in my top four.
Yeah, so funny. Yeah, he's great. He's so funny.
You mentioned earlier you wrote this script years ago. What made you want to write the script or co-write the script, I should clarify?
Yeah, like at that point in my career, you know, we're making the movie The Signal, and even The Signal was like an execution of like, how can I get a movie made? Like, I need to be able to contain this movie. I need to basically like make a movie that I can tell people is mostly in a room, and but it's this big concept idea, and that's how I'll get it made. It'll be a big concept idea, but it's like contained enough that somebody's like, okay, we can throw a little bit of money at that and make it. So we start making the movie, and the movie's kind of crazy, and I'm sort of nervous about it. And my co-writer was like, kind of had this idea about a guy talking to a drone who's caught behind enemy lines. And the more I was making The Signal, the more I was like, oh, I'm never going to work again. So we got to follow this up with something that could be more mainstream. So we just started writing it, and we were writing it on the weekends, like at this place called Satellite, one of these satellite coffees out in New Mexico. And it was interesting. Like, it was such a weird experience because we were working on the Signal, shooting it during the week, and then writing this whole totally different type of movie on the weekend. But it was cool. It was like, it's interesting directing something that you wrote like 15 years ago, because it's like you're constantly seeing a younger version of yourself with, you know, all the ideas I was having at that time about, you know, forms of violence and, you know, this and that. And it was interesting. It was totally, yeah, it was like kind of like getting in a time box and being like, oh, okay, yeah, younger version of me did it that way. That's kind of cool. I'll embrace that. Or, whoa, that's a terrible idea, younger version of me. I'm throwing that one out and I'm changing it, you know.
Very humbling, but also very rewarding. 15 years to get something.
Yeah. This business is crazy. It's so hard to get something made, especially if it's your own. Because basically people buy so much stuff in this business that all anyone wants to do is make whatever they've already spent money on. So it's always hard to get your own stuff going. So very fortunate and happy that we finally got this one out the door.
A part of me wants to consider you like a genre agnostic writer director, but you do have this thread that kind of goes through all your films. And it's about this, like, not the family you're born with, but the family you make and like staying together. Is that like a thing in your life?
Yeah, it's interesting. I never totally thought about that. I think it probably, yeah, that's so cool that you said that. I think about like being lonely a lot and being by yourself. And then I have a really hard time when I'm shooting, cutting, like I usually zero in on one, max two characters. And I like cannot, it's so hard for me to break that perspective. It's just how I sort of understand stories, but I want to get better at breaking that perspective, because big movies, you're always like cutting randomly to the villain, and you know, you need to show those things. And it's just so hard for me to break like how I think about storytelling and characters and perspective. But in that regard, like I do think about like the loneliness of an individual's perspective and how we as humans are constantly like trying to fill that with, you know, yeah, other people, like you said, family or companionship, or, you know, people to lean on and things that fill the lonely void, you know? So yeah, I don't know. They're just, for me, there's nothing better than like getting into those things in a big kind of theater, a big space, like whether that's science fiction or horror or, you know, what action, whatever it is. It's, yeah, I hope I can keep doing totally different genres, you know, and just keep pushing that envelope a little bit.
And the other thing your films have in common is like you have this great way of a push and pull of anxiety. I first saw Underwater and now this one. So for our listeners who are screenwriters themselves, what does that look like on the page?
That's so funny. You asked, somebody asked me that last night, and I was at a screening, and they were like, man, how do you, a lot of anxiety. They literally were like, how do you write anxiety? That's a good question. I mean, I think because I always have my script, but then I always have this like big moleskin giant notebook for every single movie I do. And as I'm like working my way through the scenes, I'm always like writing down what's all the physical things happening that you wouldn't want to like do on a script to make it too laborious, you know? But I think it's like, for me personally, I think I write very short and sweet, kind of like kung, 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 kung. I try to have a lot of space so it's fast to read, because that anxiety needs to be read kind of quickly, in my opinion. Like, you don't want to get the page so thick that you're just like, the reader is like, oh my God, what's happening here? I'll just buzz through it. I'll just, you know, because readers are hard. It's hard to get people to read scripts. But so yeah, if there's a lot of white space and it's easy and it's punchy, then you can write like, it's just like, what is the most, it's almost like writing anxiety. I think of it like music, like staccato, like what's the beat of it? Like, what are the physical motions that are going to happen? Is this guy slamming his hands together? Mm-hmm. Is this guy, you know, running full spore down this tunnel? Like, it's kind of just isolating the best intensity beats and then letting them live on their own. For me, this is how I kind of write it. And then letting them live for their own, just like, bam, bam, bam. Breath, stop, pause, break, you know, and then go, go, go. You know, it's like, so you're kind of like, it's like music where it's just like, you know, you're kind of following this like building tension or this staccato thing that's just hopping along. And then hopefully your page ends up, for me, being kind of succinct and intense, you know?
Yeah.
With just the important little bits. It helps that obviously if I'm doing that, people know I have like a visual style and they know that could mean more, you know?
Yeah.
But I do think even if you don't have that defined for you, it's helpful for the reader to just feel like, whoa, I slammed through that because it's so intense and fast. I remember when I read Underwater, that's how that was. Mm-hmm. Brian Duffield had written that script like so fast. It was just like tons of white space on the page. And it was like, oh my God, this is crazy. It's like terrifying, you know? So yeah, it was an enjoyable read, that's for sure.
I'm wondering too, how did we settle on the title Land of Bad?
So truthfully, so Badlands is when you're in theater, like you're in the shit.
Mm-hmm.
Or the land of bad. So it's kind of a military term. And yeah, I didn't want to use the word Badlands because there's another wonderful movie named Badlands by one of my favorite filmmakers.
Yeah.
So I didn't want to do that. So yeah, it was funny. Land of Bad happened. Originally, it was actually called JTAC. Mm-hmm. And I know there's a lot of people who don't like the title Land of Bad, but it doesn't really bother me if people don't like the title, because if they really make an effort to like say, I don't like this title, then that means it's working. Like, people are thinking about it, you know?
Like, there's a lot of anxiety is the theme of the show today, but there must be a lot of anxiety with like, I got to find a title that kind of encompasses what this movie is, but... Okay.
Yeah. We always have a title when we start writing, and the movie is never that, you know, mm-hmm. later. So I think we titled this somewhere near the end, but hats off to like all the producers and the production company, everyone involved. Like, normally I think someone would have made me change that title.
Yeah.
But I'm so stoked that they didn't. I really now love it. Like, and I love like when people are like, we're also going to get tons of those types of reviews where it's like, Land of Bad is bad. But you know what? That's like, that's totally fine. And like,
No, you're not. I mean, the movie speaks for itself. I mean, yes, the title at first, I was like, what is this? What is this going to be? And then you see the movie and you're like, this is amazing. And I couldn't even think of the title to fit it. I was like, no, Land of Bad. It is Land of Bad. Like,
yeah, it just means like in theater. So in a military concept, it means in the suck, in the shit, you know?
Yeah.
But
you can't cry in shit.
But yeah, we'll see what, you know, we'll see. I'm stoked they let me keep it. So
I stalked your Instagram, as I do when I'm doing my research. Congratulations. It looks like you got married a couple of years ago.
Oh, yes. Yep. Yeah, we're expecting another baby. We have a cute, super cute munchkin who's almost two, and then we have another one on the way. So,
and then a couple of doggies I noticed. I was like, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Some cute little, like, I'll throw them on the Instagram. They're pretty hilarious. Yeah.
So. It's a full house, but I want to ask, is your wife your reason for your vendetta against vegans? There's a lot of vegans.
Oh my gosh. You know what? I didn't actually write that line, full disclosure. Okay, that was from my co-writer, David Frigerio, who actually is a vegetarian. So it really came from, I don't know if he's still a vegetarian, but there was a long time where he was. But yeah, it's funny because he was, while we were writing it, we'd always eat at this place here in West Hollywood called Hugo's.
Oh, I love Hugo's.
Yeah, we're going to Hugo's all the time. And he's always ordering the craziest stuff at Hugo's.
It's all vegan, by the way, for listeners. Hugo's is all vegan.
Yeah.
Delicious. Yeah,
absolutely. It's funny, I actually ate there yesterday with Ricky Whittle.
Nice.
The guy who plays Bishop. But yeah, no, that's Fridge. So we can blame him for that.
Okay. Well, when I interview him, I'll wonder, what is the vendetta?
Yeah.
I'm so happy you see the show. The movie comes out February 16th, correct?
Yes.
Are you the type of artist that likes to sneak in a theater and kind of see what people are feeling?
No, I mean, like, I just like to go to the movie. So we're going to go to the movie, of course. I don't know which one. I think now it's going to play at the AMC at City Walk. So we'll probably go to that one. We just like to watch a movie, get a bunch of people together and just see it together. It's like the best part of the whole experience. So finally, like, watch it in a theater with popcorn and just enjoy, you know?
Yeah, I saw it on my laptop, my little laptop, but I need to go to the theater. I just kept thinking the whole time. I was like, this is going to be so good with the.
Oh, yeah. Wayne Lamar, my mixer who I've done a lot of movies with now, he's like Wes Anderson's mixer. So he's genius. He's sound designer and mixer. So he's unbelievable. And like the work that he did on this is incredible. And Brandon Roberts, our composer, really made a like score that is just so cool in the theater with all the bass and the, you know, all these like amazing like panning effects. So it's a lot of fun to see in theaters. So we're stoked.
I want to go back to something I mentioned earlier and I forgot to expound on it, I should say. With the humor, Russell Crowe being so funny, but also with co-writing the script, how do you know when it's too much humor? Because we're dealing with a really serious situation. So how do you know when that push and pull is like, okay, we need to dial it back a little bit?
I think that it's kind of like humor is interesting where it works or doesn't work. Mm-hmm. Like sometimes you don't know because your sense of humor can be different than somebody else's. So every time we have a joke almost in the film, there's more like there's so many takes. There's going to be other versions, like other jokes. You just can't ever just like rely on one joke. So there's different jokes and takes where there is no joke. So you really, that is a test the waters type of, at least for me. And in my experience, like every time you see something happening like that, there's a certain level of choice to it later that you can control in the edit room.
Yeah.
Especially with just like zingers and one-liners, you know. Also, at the same time, we kind of knew that that is what is so interesting about the sort of stage that this movie takes place on, because you have these characters who are deep in the jungle, in the crazy shit, and then you are
in the real world
contrasting that with the guys in Las Vegas. So
it's so good. There's a really great sequence, not to give anything away, I don't think it will, but there's a grocery store sequence where you are comparing, contrasting, which I found very humorous because that's kind of what it is, right? Like even us having a conversation today, miles away, there's some stuff going on, right?
Yeah, that was kind of the point, was like, wow, this is, you know, this crazy thing is happening here. Yeah. And life goes on here.
And life goes on. Exactly.
And Russell was so funny. Like,
so good.
We shot that grocery store sequence rather quickly. And we let Russell like grab a cart and just go. And I think he's so funny because he is such a pro and he really is dialed in about like his take. He'd always be like, Will, two more takes and I promise it'll be 15% better. Like he really loves to dial a performance, you know, and that's, I'm sure that's how you win Academy Awards. So he's amazing in that regard. But, and then he claims he doesn't like to do things off the cuff. And yet, he does this grocery store scene and we literally put two cameras on him and we let him just do whatever he wanted. And I'm like, dude, this is genius stuff. Like watching him like select his items, you know, ask about the fermented cheese. Oh, I'm like, dude. He's genius. He's and so mine funny.
Gen X and older millennials, please see the movie just to see you're like, this is Russell Crowe. Like it's so great. Because he's still him. You're like, okay, I definitely see. And then you're like this older grandpa that you just want to hug. And you're like,
wow. Yeah, I love him. I love him. He's so warm in this movie. It's just so amazing. Warm,
which is
such a
character. His name Reaper.
Yeah. But he's totally like, just like he's got the tickets. He's got the hookup for Disney on Ice, you know? he's such a like sweet guy. It's funny. After he saw the movie, he texted me. He's like, well, knocked it out of the park, man. But man, I think we really made something with some real heart to it. Don't you think? And I'm like, dude, it's all you. Like, You have so much heart. So fortunate.
As I'm winding down the interview here, I could talk to you for hours, but you have a very busy day ahead of you. I want to ask something we ask all of our guests on the show, and it's what advice do you have for your younger writer self?
Younger writer self. I would say, you know, just there's so many, it's very, very easy to get caught into structure. Obviously, making a movie is like you're trying to pack all these ideas into this tiny little watch. It's like you got all the gears have to work together and all that. And there's all these things. And, you know, of course, you can go read your Save the Cat or, you know, any of those books. And those are all good. But what I would say first, and this is because my first movie, Love, I didn't really know any of that, right? Mm-hmm. I just had a basic idea of telling a story. And then I didn't even know I didn't have Final Draft. I didn't have anything at the time. Now I do, of course. But I just would write paragraphs of scenes. And like, I would write like one a night or something. Yeah. And I want to say the most important thing is just writing something that you can't wait to shoot. And it's almost more important than all your structure, everything else. That stuff you can kind of look at later, honestly, and you can go, oh man, this is a mess. But if your movie is full of things that you really want to shoot, you're not in a bad spot. And there are so many people who write just to make one scene connect to another scene. They'll write like three or four scenes in the middle just to kind of make it work. And you're like, these scenes, I gotta do this so I can get here. That's a bad place to be. And when you're on set, you feel it. So you really just want to write stuff you want to see. And so that's the key thing. Just write something new, something fresh, something interesting, something that makes you laugh, something that makes you giggle, whatever it is. If you can walk away every time you sit down or at least every other day with one scene that you love, and then you just start stacking those on top of each other and eventually you'll have a whole freaking, that's how you make an amazing movie. It's just shit you want to see. So don't write it unless you love it. Don't do it. Because otherwise you're wasting everybody's time and really yours. So just, it's so important to just write something you really want to shoot. And then when you're on set, because I've been there where you get out of bed in the morning and you're like, oh no, I have to go shoot this scene. Oh, this is gonna be tough. That's so bad to feel like that. Whereas when you get to certain scenes, you're like, oh my God, I can't wait to do this. Oh my God, I can't wait to watch Kristen Stewart do this and try to make this scene work. It's going to be amazing. You know, that's how you should feel about every scene in your movie. So,
yes. Which last compliment before I leave and I will wrap up is, yeah, thank you for casting Kristen Stewart, our lesbian queen.
Oh, she's amazing. Yeah, everywhere. She's such a beast.
We thank you for that scene with her in the tank top. You will never.
Yeah, she's so cool. She's so amazing.
William, thank you for coming on the show. Can't wait to see what you do next. You guys,
Liam. Oh, thank you.
Go see it in theaters. Seriously, like, go see it in theaters with the sound mixing, with every of the big screen, February 16th. Take your sweetheart, whatever you got to do. Go see the movie.
Awesome. Hey, thank you so much. Appreciate you.
Thank you. Love the film. Love you. Can't wait to see
you. Thank you. Likewise.
I will leave you here. Good luck with the rest of your press day.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Cheers.
Bye. Thanks so much to William for coming on the show. And as always, thanks to you, our listeners. If you like this episode, leave us a review. And if you haven't already, subscribe to our show on Apple, Spotify, or wherever you get your podcasts. For news about new episodes and more, like us on Facebook, follow us on X at Final Draft Inc., and on Instagram at Final Draft Screenwriting. This podcast is produced by Final Draft and Chardet Sellers, editing by Sean Bonnet, and music by T. Kelly. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.